This episode of the Swoopcast is brought to you by the Mad Canadian Barbecue Company. Mad Canadian is an Ohio-based company where they say our seasoning will take your barbecue from good to great. Be sure to catch them in Cary at the OLC Shrine Cafeteria for some barbecue and bingo, again, this Thursday from 4 to 7 o'clock. So be sure to come hungry and get ready to play some good old bingo this Thursday again, 4 to 7. Be sure to check out the Mad Canadian social media site, Facebook and Twitter, for more information about him and his food truck and where he's going to head to next. Mad Canadian Barbecue Company, the official barbecue of the Cary High School Blue Devils.
This episode of the Sloopcast also brought to you by the Iron Bean Coffee Company. The Iron Bean Coffee Company is a premium, small batch, roast to order, veteran owned. Yes, veteran owned. Today is Veterans Day for many of you listening who listen to this on the day it comes out. Show a little bit of support, show a little bit of love for a veteran-owned company by going over to ironbeancoffee.com and checking out some of their amazing coffees. I'll tell you about specifically some of the amazing coffees in the next ad break. And but that being said, a little bit more about the coffee company, where all of their beans are fair trade certified, USDA organic. They're based out of Ohio, Toledo more specifically, Perrysburg more specifically than that. And again, on this Veterans Day, it is a veteran-owned, Marine-owned company. So find your new favorite coffee over at ironbeancoffee.com. That is Iron Bean Coffee, America's local coffee roaster. I couldn't tell if you froze, Kyle, or if you just got really still.
I was waiting for you to say something this time, but...
Well, yeah, but you gave your face like you were going to say something.
Hope everyone in the YouTube land is doing well. Hope our Sloop Cats are doing well today in the chat. We get to have another good old Know Your Enemy episode out here.
Nomad says, when you introduce my picks, I prefer you refer to me as the all-knowing, all-powerful ruler of the Seven Kingdoms, Nomad. How can you rule a kingdom if you're a nomad?
Well, let's let him think about that as we start the show here, Jared.
We've got barbecue back here. You're all invited. Welcome to the Sloopcast. How are you doing today, Kyle?
Doing pretty well today. How are you doing today, Jared?
Today is, for the day we're releasing this anyway, happy Veterans Day. So happy Veterans Day to everyone listening. I know our Discord server and our patrons, we have a bunch of military folk represented in there. Some former, some current, some reserve. I know we got a lot military presence in our fan base, and that's, yes, Matt, that he is the one reservist that I'm aware of I believe he's a reservist, the one reservist who I am aware of who has identified himself as such anyway. And like I said, like, we have a big presence there. So, just a happy Veterans Day, to everyone who has served or will serve or is currently serving, for that matter.
Absolutely. Thank you for your service.
This one's for you. Ooh,
there we go.
That one was a good visual.
All right. As Jared starts his beer here, we're going to go ahead and jump into Know Your Enemy, the Purdue Boilermakers. Coming into this game, 6-3, 4-2 in the Big Ten, and looking for their third top five victory this year. Will Purdue have enough in the tank for a third upset this year?
Does the Purdue super weapon travel this far east? Because, you know, the Spartans fell in West Lafayette. Ohio State, when they fell a few years back, fell in West Lafayette. Now, they did upset Iowa in Iowa. So that, you know, that was Iowa City. So we do know at the very least that the Purdue super weapon does travel to Iowa, travels west. But can it come this far east is the question.
Well, we're about to get into it. So little information about Purdue, in case those who only see their record and them having a few upsets. Let's dive deep into Purdue here. Purdue coming into this game, averaging a little more than 400 yards per game. But to my surprise, when I was really searching here, Jared, for them, averaging over 330 yards in the air.
I'm not super surprised by that. I like O'Connell in some respects, and I say I like him, but that's not their quarterback, by the way. Did I say that? I like him in a lot of respects, Aiden O'Connell. Mm-hmm. He had an excellent game, I think, against Michigan State.
Yeah.
He can throw to David Bell, which is, of course, a huge unfair advantage because David Bell is brilliant. He'll be in the thumbnail this week. He's an amazing player.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm just pulling up some of his stats real quick. In the past few games, yeah, he's been all of that. Against Michigan State this last weekend, 11 catches, 217 yards.
Yeah.
And then also against Iowa, the other team that Purdue beat that were in the top five, 11 catches, 240 yards.
Yeah, no, he is excellent.
He is legit.
Yeah, and you know, it wasn't long ago that a guy named Rondell Moore, an excellent wide receiver dressed in Purdue, made Ohio State look bad. So we need to be very, very aware of David Bell. We need to be very well, again, to go back to Aiden O'Connell. He is capable of being very good. That being said, he's also capable of hurting Purdue. You know, he has over 2,000 yards on the season, and that's with missing some time, because he has missed some time. He has 12 touchdowns on the season, but he also has 8 interceptions. So it can go either way with O'Connell. How he goes might affect, because if Purdue wants to pull off their third upset of the year, and at that point, is it even an upset anymore? But if Purdue wants to pull off their third upset of the year, then they're going to have to play a near perfect football game. And that includes their quarterback not turning the ball over.
Mm-hmm. Well, and here's an interesting thing, Jared. Denzel Burke.
Yes.
Going to go up against David Bell in this game.
Playing a lot of zone. But I gotcha.
Almost 300 snaps has played so far, Jared. 0 touchdowns allowed for the year. That's thrown in his direction.
Yeah.
As a true freshman.
Ridiculous.
Ridiculous. So yeah, this is gonna be fun to watch. Just watching Burke going up against Bell here. Yeah, I'm going to have a lot of fun. I'm going to really keep my eyes open on number 29 out there.
Yeah. So, again, I don't know how much you actually see Burke lined up directly against Bell, because mm-hmm. they'll move Bell around. You know, I don't know if Burke's at the place yet where they're going to specifically make him chase Bell around. And of course there's a lot of zone. So that's sort of the problem. Like, you kind of just leave your cornerback on one side of the field or the other, because you don't necessarily want to tip that it's a man versus a zone. Nomad says they won't leave him on Bell all game. No, they won't. Like, I'm taking a lot of words to say that, Nomad, but yeah, that is correct.
So talking about Purdue's passing game, over 330 yards per game, rushing the ball, averaging only 77 per game here.
Yeah, you're going to see Purdue throw the ball all the time? All the time? Like, is Purdue even going to attempt to run the ball? I mean, obviously, yes, they're going to attempt to run the ball, but are they going to stick with it?
Here we go again, Jared. Here we go again. Against Michigan State, O'Connell threw the ball 54 times. Against Iowa, 40 times. Against Minnesota, 52 times.
Expect that.
Yes.
Expect that. Now, of course, the bad thing is you're giving permission to Ohio State and their defensive ends to tee off and go get it, which is not necessarily a thing you want to do, especially because Purdue's offensive line, if we rate them on a scale somewhere between Akron and Penn State, they're closer to Akron than they are Penn State offensive line wise. And that's harsh. That's a harsh way of saying that. Probably not true.
Purdue has let up 25 sacks for the year.
Let's say Penn State to Rutgers or Maryland. I think Maryland was worse. Penn State to Rutgers or Maryland. They're a lot closer to Maryland. I don't want to say they're closer to Akron. That's an exaggeration, but yeah, I think this is a game in which the Ohio State's defensive players, their defensive ends, their defensive tackles are going to need to get some pressure, because if they can get pressure with just their four guys, maybe one blitzer, whether it be Nomad says, I see a lot of steel blitzes, whether it be steel or whomever the fifth blitzer might be. Maybe you bring one extra blitzer, but I think Ohio State can possibly force those turnovers that Purdue cannot afford to have by getting pressure on the quarterback, making sure that O'Connell's not comfortable, making him get rid of the ball sooner than he wants to, force some of those interceptions and try and put this game. Yeah, you could see Hickman blitz as well, Zach. Put this game away early, because I feel like this game goes one of two ways.
Yep.
This game either goes into the fourth quarter and we're all sitting there not happy about what we're seeing, or Ohio State scores 40 points in the first half. I really can see both of those things happening.
Mm-hmm. All right. So for Purdue here, talked about Aiden O'Connell, talked about David Bell. Let's get some other names in here to keep an eye out for. Sticking with wide receivers, Milton Wright, their second best wide receiver, has three touchdowns for the year, ties for second most in the receptions for the team. Also tied for second is their tight end. Got to keep an eye out for Payne Durham as well. Very big target. I'm trying to pull up his height real quick here. 6'5", 255 tight end here. Has, 36 catches as well for the year too. Definitely a guy that Ohio State has to really watch out for in the passing game too, especially if Purdue is going to be passing it 50 times in this game too.
Yeah, for sure. And what we want to see out of Ohio State this game is a more balanced attack. Maybe try and get the running game going about, get going again. And, I don't want to, I feel like maybe we've been, as a fan base, overly critical of the run game. Like, they didn't have a good game last week. They had a much better game against Penn State than I think we want to give them credit for. I think maybe the big difference between like the Penn State game and what we saw last week against Nebraska was like Young didn't get that one breakaway play. And that's not to say that everything's fine and people are overreacting, because that's not what I'm saying. There are blocking issues up front right now, and those can be addressed and those can be worked on. But I do think we're kind of overblowing it a tad, because Young is still playing really well. Did I say Young? Henderson is still playing really well. I was reading a question down here. Henderson's still playing really well. He is still very young. I think this is a good game to attempt to get that rushing attack back on track. There are some good defensive linemen for Purdue. Dean and Carl Aftis are both very good players. Carl Aftis, for example, I'm probably mispronouncing that, 30 tackles on the year, 7.5 tackles for a loss, 3 sacks, and Kyle, 3 forced fumbles on the year. Dean has 3.5 sacks and almost as many tackles for losses himself. These are excellent Big Ten defensive linemen, and it's not going to necessarily be easy for Ohio State. And we've seen the interior of the offensive line struggle against guys like Branson Dean this year. I think the tackles are doing a better job, so maybe you can keep the defensive ends in check, but Branson Dean's definitely a guy you have to keep an eye on as far as Ohio State trying to get the running game going again.
Yeah, and their safeties are playmakers too. You got Marvin Grant and Cam Allen, both really attacking. I think from what I see here, I think they're the second and third
leading tacklers
on the team for tackles. Allen already has 4 interceptions for the year too. These safeties really like to get into all the plays here. So keep an eye out for the safeties to really bite up and try to make a play.
Let's see. Just picking up some of these, saw a couple questions pop into the chat here as we were going. Nomad asks, which bullet sees more snaps, Hickman or Young? I wouldn't be surprised, or maybe I just really want it to be true, that we see Hickman getting most of the bullets. And I know they've been working on Young at free safety in practice. So I'm not saying that that's the right answer, or if that's even still a thing they're still doing. Yeah, that is a big free safety, but it's a thing they're looking at. It's a thing they're working on. I think Ohio State's still trying to find some answers at the safety position. But yeah, he's too big probably to be playing free safety, but they were trying it. I just know they were trying it. I am aware, Nomad. Another one, I saw one from Buckeye Zach here. Is it time for the tackle to guard shift experiment to end? No. You're
in November already.
Yeah, it's November. We're doing this. This is the offensive line. This is what's happening. We're doing this.
It's got to be up on the coaches to put them in a better position to excel, because I just something just wasn't clicking, because it was in October. In October, things were clicking, things were looking great, right? And we were talking about, oh, this could be the best offensive line that we've ever seen at Ohio State. We said at the beginning of the year, and we had 2 mediocre bad games, and it showcased there.
And by the way, mediocre, not even bad, mediocre. And again, Penn State has a really great defense. So I would like to look this up, but we're not going to do it while we're recording. Did anyone rush for more yards against Penn State than we did?
That's a good question.
Yeah, I'm just saying that a lot of people are trying to like wholesale change things. They want a different play caller. They want the offensive line shifted around and changed, and they want this guy fired and this guy replaced and this guy. Guys, you had an entire month plus of games where the offense looked unstoppable. And then you played some good defenses who slowed you down in the red zone. And that's not to say there aren't red zone issues, because there are. But the offense still was putting up a ton of yards. Again, there are red zone issues that need addressed. But the offense was still putting up a ton of yards. The offense isn't broken. You got to take it in stride. The season isn't going to be great the entire time. things will get better, then they'll get worse again, then they'll get better. Everything. I'm not saying everything's going to be fine, but also it's not anywhere near time to throw the panic switch and start benching, replacing, shifting people. It's nowhere near that time.
No. Nope.
Kyle, I believe it is time for an ad break.
All right, sure. Why don't you lead us off with the here are some of the good products over at the Iron Bean Coffee Company.
Yeah, Iron Bean Coffee, once again, a veteran-owned company here on this Veterans Day. You can find a bunch of amazing coffees over at ironbeancoffee.com. Let's look at the Fear No Evil and the Integrity. A pair of dark roasts. Those are the two we're going to look at today. The Fear No Evil is a black roast. It's not even a dark roast, you guys. It is a black roast. It is dark past dark. It's dark after dark. You might want to write that one down. They took the highest quality, most floral Arabica beans and carefully roasted it into the brink of flames, monitored with all five of their senses, rich black dark roast that is void of all light. The smell is smoky, exotic, and rich, and the taste is bold. That is the Fear No Evil. Let's take a quick look over at the Integrity. This is the Mainstay Selection, the Mainstay Coffee, and it is a coffee that you can trust. It is rich, dark, and screaming, do not go gentle. Integrity, our core value to do the right thing, even when no one is looking. Again, this is a dark roast. This is what, if you're an espresso drinker, this is the recommended bean for that. Organic Peruvian bean with notes of dark chocolate and black cherry. That is the Integrity over at ironbeancoffee.com. And if you're not into dark roast, well, they got plenty of flavored coffees and medium roast and other coffees that might be more your speed. And you can find out for yourself by going over to ironbeancoffee.com. That is Iron Bean Coffee, America's local coffee roaster.
This episode is also brought to you by the Mad Canadian Barbecue Company. Mentioned about at the top of the show, and I'll say it again here for those who did not hear, Mad Canadian will be at the OLC Shrine Cafeteria in Cary, Ohio for some good old barbecue and bingo. So come hungry, get your bingo stamps ready for some good old barbecue and bingo again at the OLC Shrine Cafeteria, Cary, Ohio, this Thursday, 4 to 7 o'clock. This is the only time you get to see the Mad Canadian food truck, so be sure to hit him up again this Thursday, 4 to 7 o'clock. Be sure to hit up his social media sites, Facebook and Twitter, find out more information about him and his food truck and where he will be heading to next. Mad Canadian Barbecue Company, who are the official barbecue of the Cary High School Blue Devils.
All right, Kyle, I think it is time to move into the prediction section of our show.
And by the way, Jared, it wasn't even close to like Penn State and who rushed the most yards against them.
Yeah. Who was it?
Illinois.
Oh, that's right. Cause they were sticking like 9 and 10, maybe not 10, but like 8 or 9 offensive linemen on the field. Yeah. I forgot about that. Exactly. Nomad. And it was on 67 rush attempts. Like Ohio. Kyle, I want you to do that research all over again, but this time do it based off of averages per carry. Thanks, bye.
Let's get into our picks here. So Ohio State player to watch. Who is it, Jared?
Ohio State player to watch. I'm going to say Paris Johnson Jr. Ohio State needs to figure out their interior run blocking. Ohio State needs to figure out their red zone, and I think that starts with that interior run blocking. So I really want to see Ohio State improve their red zone offense and their ability to run block, especially inside. I picked Paris Johnson Jr. I could have just as easily pointed out Whipler or even Thayer Munford, but I picked Paris Johnson Jr. just because, and that's who I'm going with. Sure up the core of the offense in order to fix the red zone issues. So Paris Johnson Jr., Ohio State player to watch.
Awesome. Well, I picked Whipler last week, and he had a crucial fumble recovery.
It's typically a bad thing, typically, not always, when an offensive lineman recovers a fumble. I'm just pointing that out, because if they're looking at the quarterback and seeing the fumble happen, it's probably because they got beat.
All right. My player to watch, mentioned him a couple of times already. That's Denzel Burke. I think Denzel Burke's the guy you got to watch on defense here. Not all the time, but he's going to be covering David Bell quite a bit here.
Yep.
Dude has over 1,000 reception yards for the year already.
Yeah.
Denzel Burke.
Once again,
player to watch.
Once again, like last week, I let Kyle have the right answer.
Kyle, yeah, do you want to go first?
Kyle, do you want to take the right answer again? Enemy player to watch.
Well, what about our guest picker? Did they say anything?
I haven't read his thing yet. Nomad, did you? Oh, okay, he's just said it in the chat. He says Bell. Well, for the
That is the right answer. It is David Bell. 5 touchdowns for the year, 64 receptions already this season. David Bell.
And once again, I'm going to focus on Ohio State improving their red zone performance. And again, that starts in the very middle of the offense. So I already mentioned his name. I'll mention it one more time. I'm going with Branson Dean, defensive tackle for Purdue. Has 6.5 tackles for loss on the season, 3.5 sacks on the season. I could have just as easily gone Jalen Alexander, the linebacker for Purdue here. I think would have also probably been a correct answer. But I can only pick one, so I went with Branson Dean. And that will be my Purdue player to watch. But once again, I'll let Kyle have the right answer with David Bell.
Uh-huh. All right. Yeah, Nomad said is right here. He is all their offense. Shut him down. And they have nothing else. Well, I mean, Milton Wright's a pretty good backup or second receiver there too. So it's not all David Bell, but it is mainly David Bell.
Everything before the butt is horseshit, Kyle.
All right. Next up, Jared, we have the key matchup. I'll let you go first for this one. Key matchup for this game.
Kyle, I'm staying on theme. Ohio State's front 5 versus Purdue's. You know what? Let's go ahead and make it front 7. Let's go ahead and throw a tight end in there as well. Ohio State's front 6, that is, because I'm good at math. Front 6 versus Purdue's front 7 on defense. That's where I'm going. That's where I'm staying. Ohio State, once again, needs... The offense is working great until they get inside the 20, then it's something has gone wrong. So Ohio State has hopefully done some self-scouting. Ohio State has hopefully figured out maybe where some of their tendencies are and trying to beat those tendencies. And again, just improving the performance of that interior offensive line and just trying to get a push. Just, you know, you're as an offensive play caller, you look a lot better when you can rush the ball for 4 or 5 yards on first down, as opposed to 1 or 2, it's a hell of a lot easier to play calls to call plays. And it's a makes you look a hell of a lot smarter when those run plays on first down actually work. So, that will be my, key matchup for the game.
Well, Nomad stole mine. Nomad here says Ohio State linebackers versus Purdue's tight ends. I was going to go more of Ohio State's bullet versus Purdue's tight ends, but
that's fair.
Same. I mean, the other obvious answer, it's going to be corner is Ohio State secondary versus David Bell.
Yeah.
just David Bell there too.
Yeah.
All right. The spread in this game is Ohio State. When we locked it in, 20.5 points. Now, in the last game against I'm drawing a blank.
Nebraska.
In Ohio State's last game, they were a 19.5 point favorite. gain a point here. Do you think that's enough? Do you think Ohio State will cover with the 20 and a half?
I feel like this game will go one extreme or the other. Either Ohio State will be in danger of losing the game in the fourth quarter, or we're going to see Quinn Ewers for the first time in the fourth quarter. I feel like it's going to be one of those two extremes. If it's somewhere in the middle, I'll honestly be surprised. It's either a complete and utter blowout, and I'm talking huge, 50-something versus 17 or something like that. Just an utter blowout. Or it'll be like both teams have 33-ish points going into the fourth quarter. Like, it's going to be one of those two things. And Kyle, maybe I'm a homer, but I'm going blowout. I feel like Ohio State's not taking Purdue lightly, which is how Purdue pulls off this spoiler maker identity, is that people take them lightly. And I feel like you can't pull out the super weapon three times in one season. The third time, Ohio State's looking for you. The third time, mm-hmm. You're not catching Ohio State by surprise. I feel like Ohio State... Thank you, Nomad. I feel like Ohio State, in this game, is going to be one of the most focused teams you've ever seen for Ohio State against the Purdue team, because they feel like they have something to prove, because they've seen what Purdue has done against Iowa and Michigan State this season. I think they come out incredibly focused. I think they absolutely destroy Purdue. I'm feeling, Kyle, I'm feeling, I think, how do I want to do this? I'm thinking 42 to 17.
Ooh, that's a hefty score there. I think Ohio State, by the way,
that's barely a cover.
Yeah,
it's a 20-point. That's barely a cover.
It's 25 points
against You know what, Kyle? Fine. Are you challenging me?
Lay it at me, Jared.
52 to 17. What now? Nice. There.
No, it's not nice. It's not nice anymore.
No, it actually is now, because I messed up the first time. Yes, it does.
Yes, it does.
It didn't the first time. That's why I had to change it. 52 to 17.
My realistic score here, I still think it's going to be a close game, but Ohio State.
Are you suggesting my score is not realistic?
Ohio State will be in control here, but Purdue just does enough to keep it close and have Buckeye fans ranting on social media about how much they don't like Stroud or the offensive line or this or that, but they still win by 14 points. I have Ohio State 35-21.
What does Nomad have to say, Kyle?
He says here, I see too many lingering questions along the offensive line, especially the experiment that is using tackles and guards. Outside of big plays from Trey Hundo version 2.0, and with the continued lack of carries by an involvement of Tegan Chop, the ground game for Ohio State has not been balanced this year compared to previous ones. Buckeyes defense is looking more stout each week, but the continued questions with our linebackers in pass coverage gives me pause against a team averaging 330-plus yards per game passing. For the third straight week, I see the Buckeyes doing just enough to win the Purdue, while Purdue keeps it close for most of the game. Taking Purdue to cover the 20.5-point spread, and he has Buckeyes winning 34-21. Wow. That was a 1-point difference between him and I there, Jared.
He predicted two field goals where you had a touchdown, which, considering the red zone issues lately, maybe isn't absurd. And let's not forget, no struggle, Ruggle doesn't miss.
Yes. That should be Ohio State's player to watch. Is
no struggle, Ruggle.
Yeah. All right, Jared,
I almost put him in the thumbnail last week, but I'm like, no. In Jimbo literally set records. I can't not put in Jimbo in the thumbnail.
All right. Some questions here. And as usual, we have Austin's over-unders. Purdue's pass completion at 63.5%.
I think that's a great number. I'm going to go over. I think Purdue's going to complete a lot of passes this game. Ohio State's goal shouldn't necessarily be to prevent a lot of passes from being completed, but rather keeping those passes short. You know, there's going to be exactly. Zach says way over, because there'll be a lot of underneath passes. And I agree. I think there'll be a lot of 2 and 3 yard passes that are bubble screens, that are tight end running backs.
100%. I'm going over as well. And this is probably where Austin's going to get us here, because this is probably where he gets us, but
O'Connell, he always gets us. He's better at this than we are.
O'Connell has only had one game thrown under 63. No, two games since it's 63.5. Two games where he's thrown 63.5% or under.
But here's a number for you, Kyle. In games versus top 25 teams, he has thrown for 72%.
Better than that. He's 75% against Iowa and 74.1 against Michigan State.
I didn't invent the stat. I'm reading the stat. Maybe there is an additional team in there, as I think was Minnesota maybe ranked when they played. I don't know, but I think there's a third game in there somewhere.
All right. Let's see. Offensive third downs at 57.5%. I'm going to go under. That seems too high for me.
No, I feel like Ohio State is going to sort of chug along this game. I think they figure out the running game this game. I think they have a lot of nice third and short situations that they will pick up on the ground. You see the return of the Ohio State short game in this game. So while I think that's a good answer, a great number, I see it in the low 60s, maybe the high 50s. Mm-hmm. It's a great number, though. I could be wrong.
Yeah. Trey Hundo, 109.5 on the ground.
Over. He's only ever done that once this season.
He's only ever done that twice so far this year.
Over 109 yards?
He's only ever done that twice this year.
How many games has he actually started, though?
He started the Oregon game, so 8.
That doesn't count. He didn't get...
Okay, then 7. He had the 277 yards against Tulsa. He had 102 against Maryland and 152 against Penn State.
Nomad made a great point. He says specifically on the ground. And I'm like, because he did have a lot of...
Yeah, against Maryland, he had a couple of great receptions.
Yeah, that's a good point. I'm still going to go over, though.
I'm going to go under. I think you'll get close to that 100. And I'm really hoping we get to see some of the other running backs get some more carries there. So I'm going to go under with that.
By the way, Notre Dame, what would be the other top 25 team that Purdue played?
Okay. CJ Stroud, 3.5 touchdowns. Well, if I'm going with what I have for my prediction, I'm going to go under.
I'm going to go over. I think this is an Olave game. And I say that because I think Ohio State's going to do some great pass blocking. And whenever Ohio State's doing good pass blocking in a game, they are that equals success for Chris Olave. Garrett Wilson is supposed to maybe be back this game. He is practicing. I believe he was practicing on Tuesday, as early as Tuesday. So with Olave back, with Njimba going next level, and with and then just Olave being Olave, mm-hmm. Maybe you get a cheap one to Ruckert. By the way, Nomad asks, when will we see a tight end shovel pass? You're not.
No. Nope.
I'm gonna go over, although once again, I think this is a great number. Cause I think if you just ask me, like, yeah, I just, cause I it would just say, how many touchdown passes will Stroud get this game? I'd be like, 3 or 4.
All right, Ohio State defensive interceptions at 1.5.
I'll go under.
I think they'll get one here.
Kyle, you're a hater.
Iowa gets Michigan State. O'Connell didn't throw a pick there in either of those games.
Which means he's due.
Mm-hmm. And here's a stat for you. Anytime that he does throw at least one interception, he is 1-3. He is 1-3 if he throws a one interception, at least one.
That's a great stat, Kyle. I don't know. It's like I look at 12-8. 12 touchdowns, 8 interceptions. I feel like he's probably really good for going 2 touchdowns, 1 interception this game, which I think is what he does. I think I might go back to under. I don't know.
All right, we have to move on, Jared.
All right. I need to give Austin an official answer. I'll go under. I'm going under. I switched it. Okay. I'm going under.
JSN catches at 6.5 for the game.
Man, that just depends upon if Wilson's back or not. Which
over. Give me the over.
Yeah, I'm going to go over as well. But again, it's absolutely over if Wilson doesn't play. And it's potentially under if he does play. So I'm going to have to go with the one that's absolutely and go over.
Mm-hmm. All right. Last one here. Ohio State defensive tackles set at 3.5 for the game.
That's just a big number. If you're going to limit it to just the defensive tackles, like if Ohio State gets 5 or 6 sacks in this game, that's a good game, right? And so, but now you're saying just the defensive tackles at 3.5, so we have to get 4 from just the defensive tackles, no defensive ends, well, no just, linebackers.
It
that's
just says
a lot.
Ohio State deep. It just says Ohio State defensive sacks.
Why did I thought I heard you say something about defensive tackles.
Just defensive sacks.
Okay, defensive sacks. My bad. Yeah, I'll go over on that.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I heard you say defensive tackles.
I'll go over as well. Against the game against Wisconsin with Purdue. Wisconsin had six sacks. Did I? Sorry. Sacks. Ohio State defensive sacks.
And I'm just going to believe Stewart because he told me what I wanted to hear.
All right. All right. And actually, Florida Buck actually asks the same thing. Over, under number of sacks by Ohio State at 3.5. Well, I think we both said over.
Yeah, we sure did.
All right. Let's get some Ty's.
Or no, never mind. Sorry. Yeah. Ty says, why are we so inconsistent? For one thing, it's an incredibly young team. And on the other thing, Ohio State's played better teams the past 2 games. You aren't going to be able to play your entire backup squad in the third quarter against Penn State or Nebraska. And don't let the Nebraska record fool you. We've talked ad nauseum about Nebraska and how before Ohio State, they had never lost a game by more than a score. It was just not super realistic to predict, maybe, but not expect Ohio State to be able to pull out their second string during the third or even fourth quarter of either of those games.
Yeah. And let's not forget too. I mean, there's other teams that are ranked high that struggled running too. Look at last week with Bama and LSU.
Yeah.
Six yards. Now, if you take out sacks and all that, they're running back 13 carries, 18 yards. They struggled in that game to run. So
yeah,
it's going to happen. It's going to happen, but it's up to the coaches now to see where they're struggling, work on that. You got a few more weeks before, well, you got now with Purdue, and then you have big brother and little brother after that too. And then the conference championship game after that. So you got very little time to fix it, but it is some time still.
Stuart asks, does Burke shadow Bell? And we've talked about this. We think he's on Bell more often than he's not, but he's not going to follow him around the field. No. Ohio State's been mixing in their mans with their zones and their zones with their mans. So no, I do not anticipate Burke following Bell around the field.
All right, Nomad, he asked, which Buckeye defender gets a score this week? You know, I would love it to be Burke taking it away from Bell. That would be awesome, but that's not going to happen. Who's going to get it? You know what? I'm going to go, let's go with,
I'm going to go Zach Harrison. That's my pick. I'll go Zach Harrison. Kyle, who do you
I'm going to go with Chambers. I'm going to go with Chambers.
That's a good pick.
I'll go with Chambers. You know, he only got to play half a game last week.
You know, if he picks up the ball, he knows what to do with it.
Yes, he does. Yeah. All right. And over under number of combined sacks for JT and Sawyer at 1.5.
I'm going to go under. It's entirely possible they go over. I just wouldn't put money on it.
Yep. Agreed. All right. We have Hoosier Buckeye Zach with some questions here. Does Burke end Bell's career after he shuts him completely down?
No. No, Bell's
Love
not
your
going
enthusiasm,
to be.
But no.
Yeah. And by Bell, again, Burke's not going to shadow Bell. Bell is still going to get his catches in this game. Ohio State's not going to shut down Bell. I fully expect Bell to have 5 or 6 catches at least and 100 yards receiving at least. Ohio State's not been good at like shutting down the main wide receiving target of any team this year. And by the way, once again, Penn State's probably going to throw the ball 50 times this game. It'll be impossible to shut down Bell. What I said, what, why did I say Penn State?
You
I'm
did.
Looking at the chat. Purdue is going to, for too many P's. Purdue is going to throw the ball 55 times this game or something crazy like that. You're not going to shut down Bell with that many opportunities to catch the ball.
Yep. All right. Tackles by Hickman, over under 5.5 tackles. I'm going to say over. I think he's going to get really involved in this game. So I'm going to say over.
Yeah.
Will evil Ryan Day make an appearance this week?
No. I don't. Evil Ryan Day doesn't show his face too often, and I don't think Purdue's done anything to bring out the devil in Day.
Yep. And will Georgia get exposed by the mustard throwers? They're playing better. They are playing better, but still no.
No. Tennessee's better, as Kyle said, but better is like it's hard to keep going down if you're Tennessee. So,
Stuart, over under number of Purdue holds from Purdue that don't get
called. Yeah, no, Matt, I know what I said.
At
I'm
45.
Sorry. Yeah. Will the offense get back on? I'm sorry, Kyle. What did you say?
Over under how the number of holds Purdue doesn't get called for at 45.
Infinite.
Yeah,
the answer is infinite.
There's holding at every play.
The answer is infinite.
All right, last question here from Buckeye Esquire. Will the offense get back on track, please?
The offense is not off track. Maybe specifically the red zone offense is not at its peak at the moment, but it's not off the track.
And I'm glad you brought that point up, Jared. That's because a lot of these games, Ohio State's moving the ball.
Yeah.
It's just they just stuttered right in the red zone there.
Which is a problem.
That's a problem, but yeah, it's got to fix that red zone offense. They got to score 6 and not 3s.
you have to, primarily, in my opinion, they need to fix their short yardage offense. If they fix their short yardage offense, everything else will fix itself.
Yep. And Esquire wants one bold prediction for each side of the ball.
Henderson only runs the ball 12 times, but has over 130 yards doing it.
Okay, and what about the defense?
The defense scores a touchdown.
All right, mine is that Ruckert gets 2 touchdowns in this game.
Okay.
And for defense, I'm going to go with a linebacker getting an interception in this game.
And that's not very bold of you.
We talk about the weakest link.
We're gonna have to do our Tony and Tom thing, where somewhere like, here's a bold prediction, and then the other one says that's not bold enough, and then we have to fight about it. Yes, Tom and Toby.
Oh, don't get me started with that. All right, Jared. I think that's I agree. Hoosier Buckeye Zach, bring in Chop and Teague in the red zone. Maybe. I'd like it.
I would like to see especially Chop get more care. I feel like he's, and as talented as Henderson is, and he absolutely is, I think we absolutely need more Mayan Williams in the offense.
Yeah. All right, Jared, that is all the questions here. Go ahead and lend it.
And that is the end of today's episode. Kyle, let's try and, God, these were supposed to be like 30 to 40 minutes. So that's the end of tonight's episode. I want to encourage everyone to join our Discord server, discord.thesloopcast.com, especially now that basketball season has started up. We were chatting some basketball. I properly addressed you, Nomad. In fact, I gave you better than you deserved.
Wow. I love you, Nomad.
This is the type of fun we have in the Discord server, as an example. That's it. Just come join our Discord server. That's it. That's fine. Kyle, do you have anything in Kyle's corner?
Well, you kind of mentioned the basketball team kicked off playing the Akron Zips, winning by 167-66.
Not a great show.
Not a great showing, and I hope to see better overall from this team moving forward. They got some tough games. Duke, this, Kentucky.
The team is
Xavier. It's not an easy out of conference schedule.
This team is too seniored to be playing this poorly early in the season. If it was a bunch of young dudes playing this poorly early in the season, I'd forgive it. Way too seniored to be showing up week one like you just rolled out of bed. They should have better leadership than that. They should be better than that.
They only had 2 players in double digits.
I'm aware.
Ugh, yeah. All right, Jared. Over in time. Let's end it.
All right. Tonight's ending music will be brought to you by a Columbus-based band called Paper Lung. They will be playing the Big Room, which is down in the Brewery District. It's are they 102.5 now? Is that their call sign? I know they've changed it a couple times, but it's the Big Room. You can check it out on an app called Bands in Town. If you guys don't, this is also a plug for the app Bands in Town, so you should also check that out. But tonight's ending music, they'll be playing in Columbus this Friday. They are called Paper Lung. They're playing at the Big Room down in the Brewery District. So that's our ending music. If you're listening to the podcast, all you have to do is nothing and you will hear the song. And if you're listening to us on YouTube, then just check out the show notes and there'll be a link to the song and you can listen to it there. So with all of that being said, Kyle, I'd like to encourage everyone to drink local beer, listen to local music, and of course, support your local podcasters. Once again, this is Paper Lung.